Today, I want to share 5 SIBO treatment mistakes you want to make sure you're avoiding if you are working on healing SIBO, so stay tuned. If you're a returning viewer, welcome back. And if you're new here, welcome. My name's Amanda Malacheski. I'm a certified functional nutrition health coach and a digestive and allergy detective. For weekly videos on how to find your personalized IBS and SIBO treatment plan, please consider subscribing and be sure to hit the bell to be notified when I post a new video every week. As a gut health coach who supports people with SIBO and IBS every single day inside my Calm Digestion Method online program, and who also interacts with thousands of people online across various platforms like YouTube and Instagram and whatever, I see people making a lot of very common mistakes that cost them progress on their way towards healing their SIBO or IBS. And I want to take a few minutes here today to talk about those mistakes and talk about what you can be doing instead. I certainly made some of these very same mistakes when I was working on healing my own SIBO case, so you know, you don't have to feel bad about it, but I want to make sure that you're aware of these possible pitfalls and mistakes so that you can do things differently and make better progress with your SIBO. So if you're someone with SIBO or you suspect you have SIBO, go ahead and click like for me just so that I know that you're here. That would be really helpful. And otherwise, let's get started. The first really common SIBO treatment mistake that I see is not focusing on the basics first. So I'm going to give out a little bit of tough love here and speak to this piece that a lot of you have probably wanted to just blow off because in your mind, it looks like I'm just going to skip these things and go straight to the most important pieces. But in most cases, making long-lasting progress with your SIBO symptoms means spending a little bit of time focusing on the basics first. So what am I talking about here? Well, I'm talking about doing a little bit of basic diet cleanup, focusing on your stress, and also doing a little bit of work to support your basic digestive function. Now, before you click away from this video thinking, all right, I've already been here, I've done that, I've heard all that, please hear me out. I know that a lot of you get stuck here going in circles around and around different diets or feeling guilty about what you know that you're supposed to be doing, but you aren't doing. And I really don't want to feed into that feeling here. But to be straight, there's a few key things you need to be focusing on with regards to basics that really actually make a big difference with your SIBO progress. Like for example, if you are trying to treat SIBO, but you're eating a really junky diet full of junk foods and sugar and garbage, it's gonna be really, really difficult for you to make progress. Now, do you have to have the perfect diet? No, that is a process. It takes time to get there, but you can absolutely do the basic cleanups to get rid of the very worst offenders. And these are junk foods, basically. Or if you're super stressed out all the time, you're eating on the run and you're really not taking time to attend to your eating habits, this is going to impede your progress. Your digestion works best when your nervous system is relaxed. And if you're always stressed out and crazy when you're eating, you're not going to make progress. And if you're ignoring or haven't at least tested some of the very basic digestive supports, things like stomach acid support or digestive enzymes, you also may not be able to make progress. These are basic low-hanging fruits that you really want to give at least a little bit of attention to before you go deeper into more complex solutions. Now, all of these won't be necessary for every single one of you, but you owe it to yourself to experiment with these at the basic level and just see if you can get a little traction from these very easy low-hanging fruit options. So again, make sure that you're not skipping the basics that lay a solid foundation for you to move farther into your SIBO treatment mission. The second common SIBO treatment mistake I see is people assuming that they have SIBO and not testing, or even worse, it's their doctor that's presuming that they have SIBO and isn't testing, and also not retesting after SIBO treatment. Now, I get it. The test is a little bit expensive, and doing the test is a bit of a hassle to do the special diet the day before and fasting while you're doing it and everything. But the test is such a key tool for evaluating what's happening during your SIBO treatment and whether or not you're on the right track. So if you assume that you have SIBO but don't run a test, and then you do treatment and you see improvement or don't see improvement, you really can't nail down exactly what that means for you because you don't have a baseline piece of data to base your opinion or conclusion off of. And then when you don't retest after treatment, you miss a really awesome opportunity to really understand how that treatment affected your SIBO. Did it change it or not? And how did your symptom changes correlate with that change that we can see on the paper? So if you suspect that you have SIBO, please run a test to confirm or deny that you even have it in the first place. You could save yourself the trouble of doing all of that treatment and focus on something else that's more important. And once you complete a round of treatment, do a retest so you can see what kind of progress you made during that treatment. Ideally, you would run this retest in about 2 weeks after you completed your treatment, whichever kind of treatment you were using. And I do know that getting a test can be kind of problematic for some of you. So if that's a challenge that you're facing, you don't have a doctor that's willing to order that test for you. I recently made a video about how to access SIBO testing without a doctor. So you might want to go check that video out. The third common SIBO treatment mistake that I see people make is using protocols that are not evidence-based. Unfortunately, a lot of times these are actually coming from people's doctors. Sometimes they order less antibiotics than are recommended. Like for example, they might prescribe 10 days of rifaximin versus 14 to 21 days, which is recommended in the research-backed protocols. Or sometimes they may only prescribe rifaximin even though you have methane SIBO, in which case they should be prescribing both rifaximin and neomycin or metronidazole alongside. And then sometimes this is coming from people just not wanting to use the antibiotics at all or to save a little money, or even getting suckered in by people who are selling something that doesn't really do much for you. Whatever, it doesn't really matter, but the fact is that there are protocols that have been proven to work and there are plenty of garbage protocols that don't really have evidence to support them. There's great info about research-backed SIBO treatment protocols on Allison Seebecker's website called SIBOinfo.com. If you go there and click the tab called Treatments, you can see the evidence-based treatments that have been researched in clinical trials and have been shown to be effective against SIBO. And even if you're working with a doctor or naturopath, it doesn't hurt to double check these protocols against what they're prescribing, because often a lot of times it just turns out that some doctors are not very well informed about SIBO treatment and about these protocols. So double check what you're being offered and make sure that you're getting the right thing. The fourth common SIBO treatment mistake that I see people making is trying too many things all at once. Now, if this is you, don't feel guilty. I don't really mean to be making you feel bad, but I want you to just check in with yourself and ask yourself, okay, when I learn about new things, do I just rush headlong into those things and try a million things at once? Or am I going at a slow enough pace to really learn about what's happening with my body while I'm doing it? Like, have you ever run out and bought, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 new supplements all at once and decided, okay, I'm gonna start all these plus a new diet tomorrow. I'm just gonna dive in and go all in. Now, I know how when you've been feeling really crappy, because remember, I've been there myself, I had SIBO for many years, and I went through all of this myself, that it stands to reason that making a significant number of drastic changes is likely to take you to your goal faster. I know it seems like that. But when it comes to finding your true symptom resolution plan, the key is actually to slow down, to speed up. I know this sounds counterintuitive, but changing only one new thing at a time gives you really clear information about which things work and which things don't. When you do this, you'll learn real information that will help you craft your unique, personalized, specialized plan that's true for you no matter what all the experts say. But if you do too much at once, you muddy the waters, you get really mixed signals, and you really can't tell what's true or not. All you get is this gray haze that doesn't really help you. The only exception to this is if you have been prescribed medications by a doctor that recommend that you need to start taking these for your health reasons, then obviously you would listen to that. Otherwise, when it comes to supplements or, you know, treatments for SIBO or even lifestyle changes, diet changes, whatever, you want to just take it easy and change one new thing at a time. The fifth common SIBO treatment mistake is skipping a prokinetic after treatment. A prokinetic is a medication or supplement that's designed to encourage good gut motility, which is the speed that things move through your intestines. SIBO very commonly relapses. Now remember that slow gut motility is one of the reasons why SIBO happens in the first place. And if you aren't supporting your gut motility, this makes SIBO very easy to recur and regrow. And this is one reason why SIBO very often recurs after treatment. Sometimes this is due to the nerve damage that's happened from a previous case of food poisoning. Sometimes it's due to structural issues like adhesions or scar tissue that's preventing it from moving well. And sometimes it's due to remaining SIBO that the treatment may not have caught, but then if the motility is still slow, it will continue to allow the SIBO to regrow. So the way to stretch your SIBO treatment success is to use a prokinetic after your SIBO treatment. A lot of people skip this, and a lot of doctors aren't aware that you need to do this after SIBO treatment to prevent a recurrence. Now, if your doctor or naturopath that you're working with is not a SIBO expert, they may not be aware that this is really important, so you may need to educate them about how important it is that you do this step. And then some people also just don't really want to do this. They skip it, they feel like it's a hassle, or maybe they're not interested in taking medication. But in any event, it's important that you do something to support your gut motility after treatment so that you can maintain your SIBO treatment success. So I'm curious to know, which of these SIBO mistakes have you made? Would you tell me about it down in the comments? I'd like to hear a little bit more from you about that. So I hope that this video helped you become more aware of some of the SIBO treatment mistakes you might be making and gave you an idea of how to remedy those mistakes and do something different that's going to really help move your SIBO treatment along. Now, if you've been making some of these SIBO treatment mistakes and you're feeling a little overwhelmed with how to navigate your SIBO treatment, I am the host of an online program called the Calm Digestion Method, where I support people who are frustrated and confused with their gut healing diets and supplement protocols, go from food anxiety, endless questions, and second guessing to a confident plan for calm digestion. So if this sounds like something you need help with, I would love to invite you to schedule a free discovery call with me to find out more about that and so that I can assess whether or not the program is a good fit for you. You can schedule that call by going to confluencenutrition.com/contact. I will make sure to leave a link for that below this video, and I'll look forward to seeing you on my calendar. All right, let me know if this video was helpful for you by clicking like or leaving me a comment. And you might want to watch the video, 4 Key Strategies for IBS and SIBO, next. I will leave a link for that here on the screen. Hope you're having a great day, and I'll talk to you soon.